is that weird guy up front who's just trying to be funny and is loud. Okay. Have we all been reading our G.I. Joe newsletters every month? Woohoo! Okay. Then you've seen my articles over the years. I'm Greg Autore. Okay? And there is someone at Hasbro in a very high marketing position that didn't like people to know that there were vendors working on G.I. Joe product. And I'm not going to mention his name, even though you probably have his book on your bookshelf. Okay? But even though I actually started working on G.I. Joe back in 99, they never wanted that known. The funny thing is, I worked for Hasbro for 4 years as an employee, doing Star Wars, girls' toys, some of the ones for sale that you guys have out there, the Princess Leia's, all of the Amidala's, the Slave Leia, which was supposed to have a much better head. 10 years worth of Mattel toys and tons of other toy companies in between. The funny thing was, I actually went to the very first G.I. Joe convention back in Los Angeles in 86, something like that. Way, 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 way back, maybe it was 88. At the time, I wasn't a G.I. Joe guy. I was working at Mattel. I was making, a lot of what I did was the Disney Classics dolls, all of the 12-inch Disney figures, which they're G.I. Joe size. They're 1/6, which is still my favorite category. And I even snuck in a couple male figures. If anyone noticed, there was the Davy Crockett, which was a special, and there was the Pirates of the Caribbean figure, both made out of Ken's. Anyone see those?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Yep. And they were very tricky because I had to make them using no new tooling, which is always a fun thing. Ironically, that's one of the reasons I got the job with Hasbro. So I actually was offered the job at Kenner Toys, which Hasbro had already bought by then. And so I was working for Kenner Toys, did the girls' stuff. They wanted to close down the Kenner plant, move everyone to Rhode Island. But they had this bad habit of laying off people once they moved into Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. Or in many cases, and a few other options like that. So I was one of the few who was offered a position and didn't go. While I was at Kenner, though, by the way, I'm Italian, so I'm going to be talking with my hands the entire time. While I was at Kenner, they had broke into teams, and one of the teams there was actually the G.I. Joe team, where they were actually working on the G.I. Joe Extreme, which was a huge flop. But as soon as they broke into those teams, I went over to the team leader and said, hey, I have all my original G.I. Joes, and I have more than I can count, and I can tell you anything about G.I. Joe you can think of, let me be on your team. I can be a designer, I'm a soft goods expert. And they're like, oh no, we're just doing action figures with big muscles. We're gonna make sure they just all have some camo on them someplace. So the people running that really had no concept of G.I. Joe when they did it. And it sold appropriately. But the funny thing was, a year after I was no longer an employee, he remembered that conversation because they were stuck on some things with Classic Collection Joe. And they're like, wait, that Greg Autore guy said that he was a G.I. Joe expert. Let's see if we can bring him in as a vendor to do this. So I ended up spending 5 years working on the Classic Collection G.I. Joe. Which was, I might have been the longest running person on Classic Collection, even though I wasn't an employee, which was kind of funny. So, and it varied. For a while, I literally was in the building for the first 2 years, even though I wasn't an employee, doing all of the stuff. But I would do the beginning stuff. So if any of you have read my articles complaining about the size of the gorilla, which still irritates me to no end, and I keep mentioning that in all of the writings, in fact, I think the next story that comes out, have you guys read the one about all of the Adventure Team figures that they never made? Has that one published yet?
I remember seeing one online about that.
Okay.
About all those.
April! That's what it'll be in the new issue. So, and I think what I'm going to do, I'm actually scheduled to write four more articles. There's two more in the hopper. So I think maybe what I'll do for the, because I've noticed that many people haven't kept up with that club because the figures have been less than desirable.
Yeah, the articles have been boring too. I'd rather see like stuff like this.
Yeah, so anyway, so what I'll do eventually here is I'll go ahead and put all those articles online so people can read all the backstories. Because then, I mean, and when they finally decided they were gonna cut it off, and I'm like, oh, there's still a ton more G.I. Joes, so maybe we'll write some other ones. So there'll be a bunch of articles, I'll put them online here eventually. But there'll be six more printed in the magazine if you're still getting it. Okay, so what I did though is I went ahead and grabbed some of the figures, some of the prototypes, just in case. Good thing I did. Unfortunately, some of them have broken over the years since they've been in the same box now for 15, 20 years. Something like that. So I've got a bunch of fun things to show you here. And I could tell you a bunch of fun G.I. Joe stories in between. There was one other thing I was going to tell. Oh, one thing I thought was funny. I was at the very first G.I. Joe convention. And that was the James D. Simone's conventions. And he was wearing a button that said 1,000. And one of the original G.I. Joe guys, Kurt Bazigian, was there, and he's like, what's that 1,000 mean? And he says, oh, that means I've got over 1,000 G.I. Joes. Of course, he was talking about the 3 3/4. And then Kurt says, well, I have over 1,000 G.I. Joes. And so he goes, well, then you need one of these. So he gives him a button for 1,000 G.I. Joes. And I remember thinking at the time, that's insane. I think I have over 1,000 G.I. Joes now. And not 3 3/4. So I've been slowly, I can't keep everything, so I've been slowly selling some things off and selling some fun things off that you might have seen out there. But let me go through a few fun things. One of the things I mentioned in one of the articles, oh shoot, it doesn't, you guys get a preview. Okay, it's the Real American Hero article. Often, G.I. Joe heads were sculpted off of real people that were working in there. Usually the designers all got their heads made on G.I. Joes, which is actually pretty cool. And they wanted to use my head for it, and I thought, this is not a G.I. Joe head, okay? You're doing a clown, great. But the fun thing was, I did get my voice. He has to go through his cycles, of course. That's the MP, yes. He just happens to be wearing a purple shirt because purple's my color. The funny thing is, so I've got these in boxes in my barn full of G.I. Joes and toys and stuff, and every once in a while I'll be pulling down a box and I'll get stuck! Events to be recognized! It's like, so my toys are yelling at me. And when it's your voice, it's really freaky. And then I do have one line, we also did a MK-47, or was it MK-17? MK-47 was later, okay. But it was a cool gun, you press the button on it, and it goes, you know, and the little light goes off, and every third time it would say something, a voice would come out and say something like, move troops forward, or position. Right, it's been a while since we did those. Anyway, so I got my voice in G.I. Joe's, woohoo! So I love that, that's a lot of fun. So I've got a mix of stuff here to show you, and you're all welcome to come closer if you want. I only bite on Saturdays. So I've got some things that were shown and never happened. I've got some things that were designed and ready to ship just before G.I. Joe finally died. And then I've got some pieces that did ship, and I've got some of the pre-production items of them so you can see them in the various stages. Would it help? Would it be interesting if I talked through the process of how a G.I. Joe was made? Is that of interest?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry I don't have as many show and tell pieces, but we can do this. So, for most of the time I was working with G.I. Joe, they would tell me, okay, I need 2 new Alphas and a Bravo for third quarter 2002. And usually that's all they'd give me. And I got to go figure out what to make. And 90% of the things I came up with actually went through. Partly because I've done toys for so many years, I started in 84 at Mattel, that I could design it within 10% of cost. And that's always a big issue, is getting the cost, because kids won't pay over a certain price. I mean, everything really is so price point driven, and you also have to balance how much tooling dollars that you're spending. And when I mean like tooling dollars, so they actually tooled this. This is the Snake Eyes motorcycle. So the tool for this probably cost $60,000. Might be more. The half track, which was one of my babies, that you could buy a house for that amount of tooling. It was like $120,000 of tooling, because you've got such a giant piece of steel, which is really expensive to begin with, and then all the additional parts. Actually, let me divert for just a second. The half track was supposed to be the new modern update of the Jeep, because I thought, we need a vehicle, and it needs to be way sexier than the Jeep. I mean, Hasbro ran the Jeep all that time. Let's make a half track. And the manager in charge was like, they're kind of boring. But we all watched, just forgot the name. Clint Eastwood?
Oh, Kelly's Heroes.
Kelly's Heroes, exactly. And how much more cooler is it to see, you know, three half tracks coming in and destroying something? So the original plan was we tool a half track. We re-released the version that was the Desert Tank Killer version. There was supposed to be a second version that had the anti-aircraft mount in it that would be OD with Pacific camo on it. And the third one was supposed to be basically European theater troop carrier with a canvas cover and a machine gun on top. And the guy in charge kept fighting me on this the entire time until we took a tour down to Fort Knox, where they used to have this wonderful armor museum. And someone pulled the right strings. We got to go into the back where the public never got to see, and we got to climb in and out of tanks. And it was the coolest thing ever. And they had one giant long building that was made in the exact proportions of a landing craft. It was literally used for practice for D-Day, where they would practice how to get their vehicles in and out as quick as possible. And in there were some half tracks and some tank killers. And as soon as the manager of G.I. Joe Group saw that, he's like, oh, now I get it. We can do it now. Because that, you know, seeing that giant gun on there and seeing the desert camo was just, you know, wonderful. Okay, so that was a whole digression. Unfortunately, it didn't sell because it was kind of at the end where G.I. Joe sales were really, really slumping. And even though they did a commercial, it didn't lift sales at all. And so I'm still very disappointed I didn't get to make all three half tracks. Anyway, okay. So the first thing you do is you come up with a concept. Now, we had to spread this out. You'd have a few that would be adventure team, you'd have a few that might be World War I, some odd things like that, but then you had modern and World War II. What I did a lot was, anytime I met anyone who was in the military, I immediately said, okay, what did you do? Tell me what you did, and I would have them spill as much information as I could get out of them. And then I would log that in the back of my head, and as soon as I had an opportunity for that, I would put it in. One weird thing was I forgot the exact name of it. It was Defense Courier, and it was one of the alpha price points, or maybe it was even the lower price point, and it was just basically a guy with a molded chest, and he had a attaché case, and it was handcuffed to, the attaché case was handcuffed to him, and he had on some fatigues and things like that. And he was just a really nice basic figure. He looked like he was going to carry whatever it was. And you never know how the military unit is going to react once you've done something like this. Sometimes Hasbro would get letters from like the 110th Army saying, we love this figure, thank you for making it. We got a certificate one day from an EOD unit saying, you know, thank you for making this, this is great. The defense couriers ended up buying thousands of them from Hasbro to use as some type of promotional gifts, which I thought was great, they loved it. But so we come up with a concept. First thing I try to do is see how much of that can I build with existing parts. So like many of your tables, many of the tables you've seen out there or your own tables, you've got it all divided into hats and boots and all of that. And at home, I have boxes and boxes of stuff that's all divided into hats, boots, OD fatigues, camo fatigues. And I would sit there like a kid on Christmas morning playing with the G.I. Joe, seeing how much I could build first. But then there's always a few key parts that you had to make. And then I would then build whatever it was, a model of it, and make it as close to production as possible so that when Hasbro saw it, one, it was already designed for production, and two, they'd look at it and go, oh yeah, I can make that. So then I would send them a model. Actually, first I'd send them a picture. And usually it would be something like this. This was one of the, we had several molded chests. And because the price points were so low, because we had the alpha price point, which was $12.99, and then they said, well, how about a $9.99 price point? And we're like, maybe? So in order to pull those off, we really had to do them without shirts for the most part. So the first one that was made was like the muscle, it was a t-shirt. And then we did this one, which was actually first used on Shipwreck, which is like a long sweater. Then we finally did, here's the t-shirt one. Here's the very first basic t-shirt one. And then we did one that was a flak vest, and I think there was a muscle shirt version too. We were going to do one more, and this was the updated full armor chest piece that is out there now. So if you look carefully at this, although it looks like production from where you're standing, and I only had to sell my idea to like Alan Hassenfeld, who was right there, so it didn't have to be too close. But this is actually all made out of Sculpey and nicely painted. So if you take a look, that's how every one of these started. Every one of the weird facial things. If you haven't tried this before, take Sculpey. You guys know what Sculpey is?
Yeah.
Okay. Get the Super Sculpey because it's the best one to work with. You can put it on any of the figures and make any type of beard or hair you possibly want, but you need to get a fine-tipped heat gun. You get it hot first, make sure it's nice and hot, and then you basically sear the outside of it quickly without getting, you know, forcing the air onto the skin itself too much, and you can make wonderful things very easily. For Disney, for the Disney Classic dolls, we did a set of what we called mask packs, which were completely pulled from Captain Action, one of my favorite toys. And so we first did the fairy godmother from Cinderella, and we did the stepmother from Cinderella, and we did Maleficent, and they basically were rotocast masks that could slip on just like Captain Action. But to make those, what I did was I would sculpt the head out of Sculpey, sear the outside of it, and then scoop out the inside with a loop tool. And then once I got the wall thickness the way I wanted it, I would go back with my hot gun, or I would go ahead and then just put it in the oven and I'd have a finished hollow part. So great piece that hopefully that can, or a technique, hopefully people can use that. So I would send in pictures of this to Hasbro, and I would send in a cost input sheet. It named every single piece on here. Now, one of the things that I was really good at was I knew all the the Action Man product and all the Hall of Fame product, and most of the designers there many of them weren't toy people. They were just like, okay, well, if it's not on my plate here, I've never heard of it. So I would go find all of these really weird Hall of Fame pieces or pieces that were made by the LC group, which is, they did all the specials. Like sometimes I would go steal, I would go get parts off of some of the Star Wars figures. No one ever noticed. I would, obviously there was a lot of Hall of Fame pieces used. I even pulled pieces from one of the 3¾ Batmans once. But part of my job was identify all the parts of that piece and identify what toy it came from so they could immediately do the cost. They would look at it, look at the costing, they'd say yes, or go fix this, it's 20 cents over, and I would fix it and then I'd resend it in. So for much of the time, I was doing that. It was like, here's the whole basic starting unit. But I also got to make the fun pieces. I made everything work. Everything was a works-like model. There weren't many of these that came out. Anyone have the OED training set? It was the only G.I. Joe, the only G.I. Joe who had absolutely no soft goods on him whatsoever. Because I molded the entire body to look like, I molded it in black, and then I even made a flange, a rubber flange that fit here so it looked like the bottom of a wetsuit, and his whole hat was a wetsuit top too. So you finally had a fully posable wetsuit. But, okay, how many of us have the G.I. Joe lunch pail? Yeah. And how many of us love that picture on the front with the frog man and the cutters and all of the bombs are floating in the background, the water mines, and yet G.I. Joe never did those. So I finally got my chance, I did these. This is cool because if you hit one of these, the whole thing blows up. And it's not, I made it blow up too, so it looks like it, all kind of cracked apart. And these actually float, so you can go ahead and attach a weight to the bottom of your pool and hang these at a bunch of different lengths, and you can have the fun of that lunch pail only 35 years later, but we can do it. But it was fun actually making this to work, because everything I sent them worked. Because otherwise, if I didn't make it work, then they would send it to someone that, like, I should have made the gorilla for the pygmy gorilla. I literally costed that thing down as tight as I could. It had no shirt. It had just a bandolier. He had nothing. So I could afford a big gorilla that was supposed to be this big with two movable rotocast arms. It would have been great. But then it was handed to a designer who had just worked on Congo. So it's not actually a Congo gorilla. It just happens to be the same size as a Congo gorilla, designed by the guy who did the Congo gorillas, and sculpted by the same person. So you've got a really nice howler monkey anytime you want. So then, of course, when I got the chance to do the abominable snowman, I made him the right size. And that took years to fight to get that the right size. And
they used them for Sasquatch too.
And that was intended from the beginning.
Yeah.
Yes. The same thing with the, there's the polar bear set that came out.
Yeah.
Well, of course, there was a grizzly. It was made for Kodiak Attack. This is the figure. Notice I had to cut down his soft goods too. So one fun thing here, he's got an updated version, newly tooled, of the old G.I. Joe
shoulder holster,
thank you. That's got bullets all the way across, like a bandolier, just to make it cooler. And then one of the things that actually, they added this in Rhode Island, I did not, I can't take credit for it, but I'm gonna pop this off and show you. And come up later and look at it, but there's 5 red scratch marks across G.I. Joe as he's got attacked by the Kodiak. So it was a big brown Kodiak, and part of my plan was, look guys, we can make the Kodiak, and then for the club, they can make a polar bear version of it. So that was actually planned from the beginning, just like Bigfoot.
The only thing wrong with your Bigfoot was it had the monkey feet, which Bigfoot doesn't have.
Thank you. Thank you. Actually, I would say the problem that has is I hate the face.
Yeah.
Just hate the face. On the Facebook post for trenches, I actually posted pictures of what my model looked like. And it had a nice, good gorilla mean face. And when I first saw the final one, I'm like, is there time to resculpt this? Please? But it wasn't like
modified Wampa.
Yeah, exactly. So, but, you know, they had great hands. They followed the pattern most of the way I did it. He had a nice wire inside of him, so you could literally, you know, make him, you know, fight G.I. Joe. And I fought all the time to make them cool in the package. This picture here, this was one of the $9.99 ones. And what's missing is there would be a full mortar right here. So this guy was like, I forgot his exact name, but it was something mortar crew. And so he had an extra one of the mortar rounds in his hand, and it was positioned right here with the mortar. So it looked like he was actually trying to drop it in. And when I designed the Yeti, and when I designed the Kodiak Attack, I literally sent them to them in boxes with them fighting or doing whatever, so they would keep as much of that magic as possible. So from this point, they would, let me back up a second. When I was inside the building in Cincinnati, showing upper management, I would literally show them this model, whatever the model is, I would show them that model. They would give the Yeti name right then and there, and then I would do the cost input. Once they moved everything to Rhode Island and I did everything remotely, then someone else ended up showing it to the head team, and then it would go to costing. And out of costing, if it worked, if everyone still liked it at that point, then it would literally go into production. So it would be assigned an engineer. They would start doing drawings on every part that didn't exist, and start sending things to the Orient. The Orient, Hasbro Far East offices in Hong Kong, they would work with the factories and they would send back first shots. This is a great example of a first shot, because what you're seeing is the soft goods is correctly sewn out of the correct fabric, but not the correct color. So that's one of the first things you see. Also, now he is actually shot in the correct colors, but he's not totally painted. You'll notice that he doesn't have his eyepiece is supposed to be silver on this one, and of course it's not painted at all. Here's another good example. This guy here did not ship. He was supposed to ship. The whole point of this figure was, look at that really cool molded Alice pack. And you can pop it open. It hasn't been popped open in many years. And you can fill it full of G.I. Joe gear. Yeah. And highly detailed if you come up and look at it. The other thing I did on it was I made the straps two different lengths, because the original version of this had an AT-4 rocket launcher strapped to the top of it. So then you could strap that on there, and it was the coolest looking figure. But I think that they ended up removing the AT-4 launcher for a submachine gun instead, which is a very nice submachine gun. I really like the AT-4. But one of the things they did was they sent all of this over in OD green, but after I made it, they decided to make him desert. So here they sent the correct desert cap, but all of these parts are shot in the right color. So even if this had been on the market, this would have only been a tan backpack. So first shots are, you know, often in different colors. Hasbro doesn't put their numbers or names, copyrights on many things, so that doesn't count. Be careful of forgeries. It's really easy to make a forgery for a prototype, because frankly, I make these out of nothing or existing parts. So the only way you know for sure that you've got a pre-production item is, has it been shot in parts that have never come out? Or does it use soft goods that was never released? Other than that, if it's any type of a hand model, you can fake it. And toy companies don't really like their models getting out. So you never saw any of these today. Okay. Yeah, so the models will come over. Soft goods may be the wrong color, but they'll be the fit. You'll check fit. You'll check the molding of a piece. You'll check all the colors. So sometimes we get every step. Like we might get this. We might get it shot in different colors. We might get the finished ones. Sometimes we get the exact finished piece and there's no pre-production shots that are odd that have ever been shipped to the United States. And there's often green tag samples. Have you guys seen green tag samples?
Yeah.
Okay. They've got a little tag on the back that says, like Hasbro Toy Company, and it's got places for signatures. Usually they send six of those to the United States. One gets signed and stays in the US. Second one gets signed, goes to the Hasbro Far East office in Hong Kong. Third one gets signed, it goes to the factory that is making it, okay? So that everyone has the same one signed off and they can know what it's supposed to look like. And then there's three extra samples. So usually those end up with the designers or the engineers, and those are the ones you can actually get a hold of. So if you find a green tag sample of it, of something, chances are you'll never see any more than three of it because there's only four left in the United States to begin with. One of the other funny things too is you might get a package in and it might be the exact die line and everything's held in place perfectly, but it's not the final printing. The final printing of the package is like one of the very last things that happens. There's a version out there of the Kodiak attack, and the packaging is like die cut out of Batman or something like that. It's just kind of funny. So that's the other thing that you can see. As long as it's still in the package, that's another way to prove that you really have a pre-production part. There's also a lot of models that are made just for photographing or toy fair models, things like that. And you can always tell those because they're always hand-painted. And that's the easiest way to identify those. So that's the whole set of models. That's a kind of condensed, but obviously in there you've got legal that's touching things, you've got safety that's touching it, and everyone in between is making sure it's working. One of the funny things, and you'll read this story, but the person who was in charge of writing the copy at Hasbro in Rhode Island was a staunch animal lover. And so on the Pygmy Gorilla, I think this one already shipped. Okay, on Pygmy Gorilla, it said on there about, and we're gonna shoot it with a tranquilizer gun. That's a little storyline if you read it. And if you look at the very last panel, there's this giant blast of flame coming at the end of this bazooka. And I think my last line on that one was that it will make enough fried gorilla burgers for the entire safari. So I always thought that was funny because not everyone sees everything and gets to see the final version of anything. Okay, let me go through some of these. How much longer do I have to talk? Okay, because I could talk for hours, so you'll want to stop me, or people coming in will have to stop me. There was a time when G.I. Joe sales were just starting to go down, and they thought, okay, let's learn from the past. What if we go ahead and start pushing it into far more adventure team? And so develop an entire segment that's adventure team. So one of the ones that we did, and unfortunately some of these models are broken, so you'll have to bear with me. But the idea on this was an updated version of the 8 ropes of danger. Of course, it had 10 ropes. And then the two lines on here, well, first of all, it was big enough to attack him. Woohoo! And then I made the ones that have the paddles on them, those two actually ended up being with wires in them so that you could actually have some more fun and posability. But this is made, you know, completely of odds and ends parts. If any of you have been to Lowe's and seen the PVC section, you'll recognize quite a lot of this. So it's like, this is 3-inch PVC. These are the 1-inch PVCs with the caps, pieces added, detail added. Same thing with the boots, just to get the basic idea of it. What I wanted was, I wanted it more like the ones, the one-man suits that they have for doing deep diving submergence. And so you could actually fit the full G.I. Joe inside there. And he had nice fabric, flexible joints, just like some of those outfits. So unfortunately, he was very expensive.
You can take the man out of that?
Yeah, you can.
That's good.
Can you get him back in again?
You would have been able to easier on the final one. So this is still, you know, still we can't solve all the problems, but that was the plan. In fact, this guy actually has that muscle shirt body in here that I had mentioned. So he's in here. So yeah, the idea was that you'd be able to pull him out and it would be the costume, and then you've got your fun thing to attack him with. And then he had several different...
It does
look a lot like that. It's not. It's all PVC, but... this was like for mining on the bottom, looking for minerals. We had a grabbing hand, and I think I had one additional hand you could snap in here too. We wanted to do another desert set, but we've done so many. And so this guy, I'm trying to remember on this knife. This knife was actually a kukri from the Gurkhas. And I actually got to borrow one from a major in the Rangers who was given one as a gift. And so we literally duplicated that. And this, the kukri did come out on one of the figures. I can't remember which one it finally came out on.
Jungle guy.
Which one?
The jungle expert guy. It was a lot smaller than that though.
Rakondo,
yeah.
Rakondo.
I think it was Rakondo.
It might have been that one. Okay, yeah. And it could be that I couldn't get a hold of that and made another one by hand.
Yeah.
Which is quite possible, because
yeah,
sometimes that happened.
Kukri's got a reverse blade. Almost like that.
Okay. Okay, it's been a few years. My memory's off a little bit. By the way, I'll get all the names wrong because we would work on these names for you know, 6-8 months, and then marketing would change it at the last minute.
That looks like a good $10 figure.
It looks like what?
A good one of those good $10 type figures.
Well,
doesn't have a lot of stuff.
You could have molded on it, sure.
Yeah.
Could have, exactly. And we probably would have in production. He was supposed to be an alpha, so he's the lower one of the lower price points. I really liked having a Foreign Legion hat for him, even though this was existing. He was actually Action Man.
Yeah.
Really nice canteen that G.I. Joe didn't actually use, I don't think.
Johnny was.
Actually, no, it was Action Man. This is an Action Man.
Okay.
Yeah. His feature was really cool. I'd watched The Mummy way too many times. This has actually got wires on the inside of it, and it would snap into place here on this shield. And the idea was that you've disturbed its rest. You've disturbed the guardian of the whatever, you know. And then... this would, you know, come alive, and then Joe would have to battle, which I thought would be, you know, very Johnny Quest, and very fun. Now, hold that thought, because we're going to come back to this, because I wanted to do some things where 1 + 1 = 3 instead of 2. So one of the other sets we did was more of a Indiana Jones type. Okay, he had some nice soft goods pieces on him. He was a more deluxe figure. And then he was going to be wrestling a giant snake. And it had a wire in it, and it was kind of fun. The final analysis on this is, unfortunately, kids could just go buy a big rubber snake, so it wasn't really that much fun. What I should have done is made it a two-headed snake, like that Aurora set from the Cro-Magnon woman.
Yeah,
duh.
Yeah.
I didn't come up with that in time, but that would have been a lot more fun. And I just popped the head off. Okay, But the snake is now dead. Joe has conquered him. The cool thing with him was, what he was going after was the crystal gorilla skull. So I think they're called the ruby gorilla skull, which was kind of fun. Back to very much of a Johnny Quest type of a thing. But you take this, and it's the old red lens thing, and you put it over the shield here, and you can read some secret messages like, you know, G.I. Joe lives, or I can't remember what the messages were at the time, but that was the plan. So that if you got both pieces, you actually got to do something more fun with both of them, which was fun. Okay. I showed you this guy. Oh, this guy was fun. Not every really cool piece of warfare actually was in a war. And one of the ones I really liked was they referred to this unofficially as the pepper box. It was a real item, and it was from the 80s. In fact, how many of you know, remember Don Garrett? He was a Joe Club guy for many, many years. You know Don, yeah. So Don would help me with some of these. He had evidently played with these in when he was in the service. So you pop open the front and the back, and now you can shoot. Of course, this has been stuck in here for years now, but it would shoot out the four missiles if you hadn't had it. Oh, you know, it would help if I used the right end. There we go.
Yay.
Woohoo!
Cool.
So I thought that was really cool, and of course it sits on his shoulder like a bazooka. This was supposed to come out as a desert version, which would have been cool, but what a fun weapon. Who doesn't want to shoot four things? And one of the things we did, we actually started making some of the shooting things more realistic. So we did go talk to clubs, and we're like, the feedback we got was, as long as you make it look realistic, which this is still almost perfectly accurate, and make it shoot, great. Because then you've made the kids happy, and you've made the collectors happy. Okay. Briefly on this guy, one of the things I loved on him was, now he actually, this piece here was actually from the Action Man Archer, which was a really cool figure. If you've never played with it before, you literally can press a button on his back and he releases his fingers, which are holding the string, and it'll shoot the arrow. Really neat. But so it had a spot for three arrows. But I thought, well, I want to make an ultimate Snake Eyes, but Snake Eyes doesn't always know who he's going to be up against. Sometimes he might just need a giant katana. Sometimes he might need a serrated version. And then there was a third one, which I think was the sword from the Japanese officer, World War II officer. And so you got to fit in three different swords in him. And it was really pretty cool. But you kind of didn't notice because he was in the package, you know, like this. So a lot of the really fun things didn't happen. Have you guys heard the story that I did about the figure called Gadget or High Tech? It was named, finally came out. High Tech. He was kind of a little MacGyver type of a guy. And he came with, and I can show you the pictures, he came with eight accessories. It was like a flashlight, action for a gun, an ice axe, blah, 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 blah. You could combine them into 22 different weapons. And they didn't show it on the package at all. It was like, really? You asked me for a feature. I made you the coolest feature ever, especially if none of them had seen Mike Hazard. They'd never seen anything like it before. So I made like a Mike Hazard on steroids, and it was so cool with all the pieces that would fit together, but it was never mentioned on the package, which ironically made me then decide I needed to go to the dark side, and then I eventually stepped into marketing. So then I could make sure and pull all the strings so that after it was designed properly, I could make sure that it was packaged properly, and communicated properly to the consumer. So now I kind of do a blend of, I used to be the design guy who did marketing. Now I'm the marketing guy who does design. So it's just kind of slipped the way it's done that. Kamakura, one of the fun Real American Hero figures. So I've got him here. Sometimes we would actually get first shots with no clothing. Okay? He had really cool clothing. He had a nice gi that was very detailed. I'm really surprised they let this much money go on this figure. But and he's got the molded hands that are actually the biker gloves, but in this case they were fun for this because they gave him a little more protection. But he had all these really great little armor parts, like the greaves, and he's got the knee pads, and they all had places to hide knives. Because we all need places to hide knives, right?
Yeah.
So he had all these great spots like that, and he had the nice throwing stars. And I thought this was a lot of fun. It's a shame it didn't ship. Because this guy was ready to ship. It's two grenades on a string. It's a grenade bola. So you can go, you pull the pins, boom, wrap it around their head, kaboom! Problem solved. I thought it was brilliant. Okay, I grew up in the violent times of the 70s. And my favorite weapon. I can't remember what the marketing angle was for this at the time. It may have been part of the cartoon. But they decided they wanted to do, they would go into like a ninja world, ninja time world, and time would slow down when they were doing their ninja stuff. And so they wanted weapons that would become ninja weapons. So I thought, I can do that. That sounds like fun. So let's see how many blades we can hide in here. Oh, first of all, of course, it shoots. I love weapons that shoot, because I'm still a kid. So it shoots, and then after you've shot it, there's a nice blade in the front. You pull out the back, there's a nice blade in the back.
Is this
lasagna? Yeah, exactly. That's it. Yeah, and this wasn't file shot, so it's a little sticky on some of its parts. And then there was two more here. They went out of the handle here, out of the stock here. And so what I had done, because I always sent pictures of how they were using it, so I sent the picture of Kamakura going like this. You know, so it was like, it's a batlet. I mean, I made the G.I. Joe gun, you know, into a batlet, which I thought was really, really cool. And it's really disappointing that didn't ship. So, okay. One of the other things, in case you're one of those strange people who doesn't take G.I. Joe's out of the box, he was made two different ways. So you've got a button on his back. Where is his button? By the way, that little clink sound, if you've ever listened to it, and if you've ever watched Band of Brothers or Saving Private Ryan, that little clink sound was put in by one of our engineers who was actually in the Marine company. There was one in one of the, back this up, he was a Marine. His company was one of the first ones into Kuwait City. So that was one of our engineers, which is really cool. So we would always go back to him and say, is this accurate or not? But he's the one who actually came up with the whole idea for the G.I. Joe salute and made sure it was perfect. So and he engineered that. But so he was like, you gotta put in the clink sound for when it shoots out the extra part on the M1 to make it more accurate. So I don't know if anyone ever noticed that. It's not a defect, that was intentional. One other direction G.I. Joe wanted to go, or they talked about going on G.I. Joe, at the same time as Adventure Team, was spy. So G.I. Joe obviously originally came with the footwalker, which most of us had. And so this would be an updated version. Now granted, this is a very glorified version, but, and then on the back of it, you can see that everything in here sets up so that Joe can be Secret Agent Joe and go on three completely different Secret Agent missions, completely changing his costume and his face, similar to what we did with the Secret Agent G.I. Joe vintage one, and of course with Captain Action. So then all of the parts in here too were, instead of, you know, so much of the parts were chunky because we used a lot of the tooling from Hall of Fame, and Action Man used Hall of Fame and then kept doing chunky. So we slowly got things down to really nice and realistic for Adventure Team. So this one was all nicely proportioned perfectly. So is that cool?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. I absolutely love this. And so you can make him into a Eastern European despot. You can make him into we had a version where we made him into a cameraman, and the camera would actually then turn into a machine gun and shoot, which was really cool, but that was for the Secret Agent. Look for that in the magazine. Now, this looks like I literally stole the Mike Hazard trench coat. It's not, it's better. I put in all the fun seams and holds even more stuff and holds it, you know, easier. But it certainly had a big influence on me.
That's the only prototype, right?
This is the only prototype. Okay. This is it. Some things that were, there were different ones, but this is the only one. These three adventure teams are the only ones. These are one of a kinds there'll often be things that go along the way. Like we actually, on Kodiak Attack, we went through four different costume versions for him. And this is the final one, which is rare. Normally we nailed it first or second time, but there was a lot of opinions on him. We had one in a flannel shirt. We had one in a hunting, more of a rifle hunting jacket with the pad thing here. Different versions of it, but people weren't happy, and then they weren't happy with the cost, so he went simplified. So obviously he was hunting that grizzly bear on a warm summer day. but then his coat here reversed also, so it was completely reversible from black to gray. The pants stayed black. He had a really nice bulletproof vest. And just a lot of really, he's got a full weapon set that you could, you know, pull apart to all the tiny pieces. In fact, it was that set of weapons called Weapon Tech. Yeah. It was put out by Hasbro, which were actually really neat. So we used that to get the fun of this across. And we used the super articulated G.I. Joe.
Is it the same like at the shake case they have from the Secret Agent? I see it at the shake case in the bottom.
It is. It's Big Jim. whenever you see the four digits and four digits with a space, that is a Mattel part. That's what they've done on everything for at least up until 94 when I left. That's their signature, right? They still do that a lot. So I can either answer questions, you can come up here and look at this fun stuff. I've got the presentation here, there's a lot of, in fact, maybe I should just talk through these ones real quick. Here, you know what? I'll at least hold it. Well, you know what? Actually, do you want to come closer and I'll go through this real quick? It's a nice mix of accessories. Oh, yeah. Four missiles. Thank you.
Hey, Doug, I should see it.
It's very possible that I'm going to show you a couple that actually came on the market. This particular department I worked with, they weren't good at communicating back with me whether they put it on the market or not. And then, as you know from accessory sets, they were all specials, so you never knew when they were going to show up where. So, okay, so here's our nice, you know, cover page, but let's start going into stuff. Okay, so I've worked for a ton of companies, and with a ton of licenses, G.I. Joe, all sorts of Disney. The Disney princesses are because of me, because I convinced Disney to put them together into one big set. All sorts of fun stuff. Okay. Oh, and here, I put on here, here's more important, here's my credentials. These are my first toys. So I've got the Marine G.I. Joe, I've got the Gold Knight, and the Phantom Captain Action. Those were my prized possessions as a child. So the line for me between toy designer and toy collector has always been very blurry. Gear. When G.I. Joe came out, the selling strategy at the time was razors and blades. You sell them the G.I. Joe, that's the razor, and then you sell them all the fashion, for Barbie it's fashion packs, sorry. For here it's adventure packs. They kept changing the names of the different, what they were called. So the idea was, let's sell a bunch of different adventures or missions to go on. And here's some of the classics. So these are some of the ones that they revised and brought up. So here's some of the fun ones. Pacific Marine Bivouac. Now this one actually had a half shelter in it. And I don't know, I grew up in Scouts with those half shelters, the pup tents, and they were miserable. But they made great G.I. Joe items. So this had everything in it so that you could set up your own bivouac. It had the entrenching tool, and it did have the little grease gun, so you at least had a good and expensive gun. There was also Pacific Marine bivouac, which was with the sleeping bag. They weren't sure which way to go with this one. And by the way, if you've ever slept in one of those real sleeping bags, well, they'll keep you warm, but they're really like, I couldn't wait to get out of it. You know, just, I had to sleep in one night in Boy Scouts because I had an issue with my sleeping bag and locking it in my car. So I had to use one of these, and they're not fun. But anyway, this was a great set because it came with realistic World War II pieces. They didn't make it. This one was Navy SEAL set, which was a smart bomb tagger gear. The idea was, actually someone else would be, wait, is this the one? Hold on a second. This one was actually the Stinger missile one. So I didn't name this one correctly, sorry. Maybe I've got it named on the next one, which should be the tagger gear. Here we go. That's the tagger gear. So if you ever saw the scene in Clear and Present Danger, where they're putting the laser onto the building, and then the smart bomb is coming in to blow it up, that was the accessories to make that fun happen. And this one actually came with a smart bomb that had fins that would pop out. It was really cool. Now this was actually released under a different product, but I thought that was a great set, and it's a shame that one didn't happen. We all had the ponchos, okay? This is the Ranger Recon gear. So I wanted to make the best poncho ever, modern poncho. So a friend of mine, his brother was a major in the Rangers, same guy. And I said, does he have a poncho? Can I borrow it? He did. It had still been stuffed into his rucksack from Grenada. And it smelled to high heaven. It had not come out during all those years. And so I literally had to keep it in the garage to work on it because it just smelled so bad. But I went through and I made it perfect. This model has like every seam on it perfect. And then it went to the soft goods engineering group in Rhode Island, and they're like, oh, poncho, yeah, we use this pattern. Yeah. It's like, oh, I made it perfect. So anyway. Those things happen. Winter camo. We did some really cool winter camo stuff that never came out. Like this was actually a poncho set, which would have been cost effective, but for some reason they were always afraid of winter stuff. There wasn't very much winter stuff, as you know. In fact, I'll be showing pictures of one winter real American hero in the magazine that they never shipped. But it was a really cool set. G.I. Joe Special Response Team, we were doing more with, in fact, one year we looked at, do we just do civil authorities? And so we were doing all police, firemen, tobacco, and...
Alcohol, tobacco, and firearms.
Thank you. We actually did that one, and we actually had him with a sniffer dog. A bunch of really fun things, and we even had a sky marshal, which, let me digress another way. I made the sky marshal with a taser gun. I thought, that would be so cool, because that's what they would have. So I made the projectile so it would work, and I put little blue lightning bolt blades on it that would pop out, and it would have Velcro, and it would come with a shirt, you could shoot it at someone, it would pop out, and it would go pee, and it would look like it's electrifying it. It looked great. I also just built the perfect choking weapon, because it would go into a child's throat, and then expand, and never come back out again. So we can get excited sometimes and not quite see what we're doing. So, but this guy was great. Actually, this is another one I worked with Don Garrett on. We went through, what are some of the less than lethal? If you look at the stock of his gun there, it has LL, which means this gun is loaded with less than lethal rounds. In this case, it would be shooting...
rubber bullets.
Pepper spray.
Actually, I think this one was the rubber bullets, but I've got another one that was... the beanbags. This one, yeah, the beanbags are the next one. So we did a variation, and this one was the beanbag one. They would shoot, this was tear gas, sorry. So the other one was beanbag. And they would come out of the shotgun shells. So this one was a full riot gear, and then we also had the gas gun, which ironically, they're still using a variation of the Vietnam era little, I can't remember what it's called, but the little, yes. You know, they're using a variation of that for the gas gun for riots. So it was a great looking set. It came out, it was supposed to come out the same time as one of the SWAT figures came out, but there's always an issue with, they're on two completely different systems. So even though there was a great World War I set, which had a pigeon and everything, it came out like 5 months after the Doughboy had already come and gone. And it's a shame because there were beautiful pieces. There really were some, there was also supposed to be a whole set of Apollo pieces that were to come out with same time as Buzz Aldrin. Same issue though. There was three different sets, but they stopped them all because they just couldn't ship them at the same time. They were actually shown at one of the conventions in Washington, the Washington D.C. convention. There was that big giant display. I made that years and years ago. Okay. Real American Hero. Night surveillance gear. Just very cool high-tech gear, where you could listen in, and this was the weapon which I loved, which we made for, I forgot the name of it, because we changed the name of it.
Venom and Valor.
Which one?
Venom versus Valor, the class pool, the one you put together.
It's the one you put together, and it was all different pieces.
Yeah.
It was originally supposed to be like Night Assault or something like that, and then we decided, oh no, it's now gonna be Real American Hero, so it's now, whatever his name was.
Heavy Duty or something.
Yes. I think it was Heavy Duty. Yeah, that was it. But it was a beautiful, if you ever get a chance, look at the detail on that gun.
Before we go on, Miss, could you move out of the way? You blocked the screen.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Okay. This was, let's take the old big foam missile launcher from Hall of Fame and see if we can make something out of it. This was still kind of dorky because that accessory is kind of dorky. This was really cool, where we took the little sea sled that was in Danger of the Depths, and we put it in this new kind of a underwater camo with a blue ripple effect with a bunch of accessories and high-tech gear. I thought it was really neat. I'm disappointed that one didn't go out. This one was peak shot gear. The idea was he was going to climb to the top of a mountain and then shoot something. Whatever needed to be shot, I don't know. Dignitary, Hillary Clinton, I don't know. These were fun. This was, I think, part of what was going on with some of the small figures, which was, let's make a dress-up kit. There was a Cobra infiltrator, and there was a G.I. Joe infiltrator. So there was a G.I. Joe set where you could dress up as either a Cobra infantryman or Cobra Commander by rearranging the pieces. And then there was the same where you could make it look like just a, like either Duke
or you could make it into snake eyes. I thought it was really cool. Fun sets. Didn't happen. This was dorky. This was, they had designed for a small figure a snake soldier, and they wanted that in a set. And he had like a big whip arm. The one thing that was cool about it was I made it so that the head was rotocast, and you could squeeze it and it would squirt out water. So you had, you know, streams of venom. That was the coolest part. And even though all these parts I've shown you have been rotocast or soft plastic, I developed ways to make it still soft and work just from trial and error and experimenting. So this really did work. Anything I sent to them worked. Coils of Doom. We looked at Coils of Doom, literally just, you know, taking the vintage set, using all existing pieces, and doing it on a card. Would have been nice. I mean, just, I never got the look of the snake. Of the snake the way I wanted. There's a thing called an emerald boa, or is it emerald anaconda? Forget which one. Big nasty snake, emerald, that look incredible, but when you put them into a toy, it just looks like a toy. So I should have made it look with normal printing. Finally found a good use for that pygmy gorilla, which was, I made a set that was, let me get rid of this, whatever that is. I made a set that was kind of like Outbreak, where it had a very cool high-tech hazmat suit, and this helmet was actually existing from Action Man. And then I took the monkey and painted him to look a little weird, like he was a little diseased, and there was this really cool drum that was a partial drum looking like it was spilling out from Action Man 2. And I thought that would be really fun, because then you actually had an excuse to go into the jungle to go get the monkey or whatever, you know, for some reason. But for some reason, they all hated that one. I loved it, but oh well. At one point, they said, make me some, like, Big Trouble in Little China. So I did. I went back and used the pieces from Mortal Kombat. Thank you. Went back, so there was a mix of Mortal Kombat, and there was a lot of ninja sets that were done for Action Man. So I kind of pulled a combination of some of those. So this was one set, which he actually had, I thought it was funny, these blades. The blades fit on something else too. Maybe not, maybe they were just hand blades. But I think they came on, I think they were like skating. I think they might have been the skating things off of one of the Action Mans. I thought it would make nice blades. And then here's basically the Ninja Training Center with, you've got a rack and you've got, you know, every ninja gear that I could possibly afford to put
that's
in there.
That's exactly the same as Action Man, except it's got shuriken, the other one didn't.
Yeah, exactly. Because these shurikens, I remember I designed them for probably Snake Eyes. So Action Man didn't have those. It was fun though, because after a while Action Man started stealing the G.I. Joe parts. It's like, yeah, you're using my dog, you know. Oh, and that was it. Okay, so those were all ones that were planned. Unfortunately, they never happened. Yes?
They did a like secret agent set or special service set for like, it was an FX convention that they had some G.I. Joe stuff. Did you work on that stuff at all?
I did not work on that. There was actually two different groups designing G.I. Joe.
Okay.
There was one in Rhode Island, and there was one in Cincinnati. Eventually, okay, they all were in Rhode Island, but then there were still two different groups that okay, really didn't get along very well.
Okay.
Which was a shame, because they could have coordinated their efforts better, but.
I found this very interesting, thank you.
Sure. Yes?
Well, now, of course, I don't know if you have anything to do with this, but why did the original G.I. Joe have such unusual hand positions?
That's a good question. Well, I think the idea was, of course, at the time, you didn't have soft materials very well,
yeah,
which is, to me, it's insane. It's like, guys, Marx knocked you off 2 years later with great hands. Why didn't you ever fix them? Until they finally fixed them for Kung Fu Gorilla. But I think it was supposed to be, this finger goes in the trigger
and this figure finger is holding, but it's still kind of weird.
Well, the only problem is, it was like the hand was like that.
Yes, yes.
And it rolled under, and I don't know if you ever handled the rifle, you do not put your unrolled fingers on it.
No. Now, if you notice, when we did the figure with the totally articulated figure, mm-hmm. we made sure that one of the hands went like this, and the other one literally goes up and down. So finally, there was one that could hold a weapon correctly.
Yeah.
And that was actually, the guy who made that happen was a Vietnam vet.
Okay.
He was like, no, that's not how you hold a gun. We're gonna fix this. Oh, this is a, there was a very short-lived idea to take G.I. Joe and make him kind of like Commando. Like Arnold, they wanted, let's make a big Arnold Schwarzenegger Commando. And this was the Sky version, and this model is falling apart, but what I liked on this was, it was a jetpack, but I don't want to just pretend jetpack. Let's pretend jetpack by having flames come out.
Oh,
so,
that's crazy.
Can we do that again? Okay, so jetpack, and of course these were supposed to go all the way up, so you didn't see them, and then, flame on! And they would have been molded so that they would have spread out more once they popped out.
That's a great idea.
Now, it was interesting because we made a water guy, an air guy, and a land guy, kind of like the original G.I. Joe, and then we made a Cobra Commander that was actually inside a robot body. Because one of the cartoons, which the marketing person at Hasbro, who wrote a book, hated. One of the long cartoons, Cobra Commander was turned into a snake at the end. Okay? So what I was doing was, great, let's make a robot. And then what happens at the very end is they would shoot at each other with IR guns. And at the very end, if you hit him three times, he'd go, I'll get you next time, Joe. And the head would pop off, and a cobra would jump out. It was so cool. But of course, G.I. Joe couldn't die. If you shot him three times, he'd be like, I'll have to go reload. You know?
It's like that'd be more interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
I'm sorry, what did you say?
I was going to say, all these knives, the corpse coming out, this may be more dangerous to the user.
It's not a pair of ninjas.
The whole idea was you were holding it like this and doing this.
Also, rule of thumb is you never bring a knife to a gunfight.